Good afternoon to all who have joined us in this webinar. I, Nitin Lahoti, Manager Innovation Management, NIAM Agribusiness Incubator, welcomes you all on the behalf of National Institute of Agricultural Marketing and Center for Agricultural Marketing Planning and Development. Before I proceed further, I would like to request all of you to please keep yourself on mute unless you want to talk. And we have kept separate timing for the question and answers, hence request you to
Hello.
Yeah, I can't hear Nitin.
Girishi, we can hear you.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. So.
Please start.
Should I start?
Okay. Nitin.
Hello, Nitin ji.
Yes, ma'am.
Please continue.
Yes, I'm starting now. Okay.
Okay.
Sorry for the slight lag here. A very good evening to all the participants who are here with us on this webinar. We are very thankful for giving your time here. This COVID time, we have seen a lot of agency rules have undergone change. And we also see how direct marketing has been adopted by states like Madhya Pradesh, states like Uttar Pradesh, and of course it's coming into Rajasthan also. And these are the times where we are thinking about how farmers can have better options for direct marketing. But all said and done, we need to know a little more about direct marketing. Direct marketing actually doesn't really mean that farmers can sell directly to the consumers. There are more to it. And what are the facilities that the farmers would require to get directly connected to the companies if they are the buyers here, or to the institutions who are there for the traders, and how they can better be organized to have this kind of a capacity to be able to come on the direct marketing. For all this, to know a little more about the direct marketing, what are the the challenges that we face, how we can mitigate them, and how we can make it more interesting for the companies to come on board and give a better chance for the farmers to be able to kind of trade with the companies like ITC and Cargill, etc. We are really happy to have Mr. Girish Avani, who is a very experienced person, and he has a kind of an experience in procurement feeling. And he has headed the institutions like, or the companies, I'm sorry, the companies like Cargill and ADM. And he has also been associated with Olam. And we all know these three companies are world's companies who are into the procurement of the grains and other commodities. So we are very thankful to be able to kind of give this idea for the direct marketing. So once again, I welcome Mr. Girish Avani here today, and we look forward to your interesting presentation. Thank you, Mr. Girish.
Sure. Okay, can everybody hear me and see me?
Yes, Girish.
All right. So, welcome everyone. This is Girish. I head an organization called South Asia AgTech Hub for Innovation. Just to give you a background of my past professional experience. Just a second, I don't know what's the problem with the slide. Sure. Can you see the second slide?
Yes.
Okay. So So this session is largely to share my own experience. I have about close to 11-12 years of experience in the agri supply chain with ADM, Cargill and Olam, having worked in India, Indonesia and Ivory Coast. This session is largely about my experience with Cargill in India when I was heading their procurement and operation. And this is an experience from the years 2003 onwards till 2010, 7 years, what we learned and what we saw. Now, when we look at the definition of farmer buying and trade buying, as we know that farmer buying means buying directly from the farmer without any previous contract, where the farmer comes to your warehouse or your buying point to deliver his material. While as under a trade buying, what usually happens is you speak to a trader, which is an arthiya and a mandi or a commission agent. You fix the quantity, you fix the price, you fix the quality, and you also sign a contract. And he has to then deliver it to you against that contract, deliver the material to you against that contract. Now, I would like to take you back a little bit in time to 2002 and 2004. If you look at what these companies did, during these 2-3 years, ITC started with its e-Chopal model. Cargill started with its Sathi Krishi Samadhan Kendras. Mahindra started with its Shublab model. Godrej started with its Aadhaar model. Shriram started with Haryali. And Tata started with Khetse. So each of these companies have thought that their business model and what they have started is a game changer. There were a lot of interviews of these managers, a lot of photographs, a lot of articles written about them in print. All these companies and these business models used to get prime spots in agri conferences. It was supposed to revolutionize agri business. It was supposed to revolutionize agriculture. But if we look at what happened within 3 years, was as follows. ITC's e-Chopal was closed across most of the states. It had expanded rapidly with the model. They had gone to many states and many villages. It was closed and it was kept operational only for wheat and soya, which essentially means that it was kept only active for the processing, the processed commodities, because ITC was manufacturing atta under their Ashirwad brand, and they were also manufacturing soybean oil. It was the e-Chopal was kept active only to buy these commodities directly from the farmers. Then Cargill's Sathi Krishi Samadhan Kendra was closed across all the states. Mahindra's Shublab was closed, and the team was relocated to the grapes export department and team. Godrej closed its Aadhaar initiative. Shriram closed its Haryali outlets. And Tata's Khetse was closed and was merged with the Tata Kisan Sansar. So I just wanted to understand, and I also want this session to become a little active and more participative in nature. I want to know from the participants that what do you think happened in this? Why did all these initiatives, which had started with a lot of shoshebazi, if I may call it, why did these close? Any idea? Any answers? Please feel free to participate. Please feel free to just switch on the mic and speak. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
All right. So anyways, so let me not wait for answers. Let me just move along. Just a second, there is some problem in changing the slides. Just wait for a minute.
Sir, one answer has come from Ms. Shreya Das. Was that a unit economic
issue? Yes, it was partly a unit economic issue. The units were not viable as we thought them to be. But let's see what actually happened. Let me try to move these slides. There is some problem in moving these slides. Do you guys have a copy of this presentation? Can you put it on screen? Because I don't know what's happened here. I got it. Thanks.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. So if you look at this one, farmer versus trade, look at it from a commercial decision matrix. Now, whenever anybody is buying from the farmer or from the trader, everyone is buying, every corporate is buying to sell it onwards. You sell it onwards either to a processor or to an exporter or to a retailer or to a trader. Now the buyers who are there, so let's say if you are a commodity buyer in a processing company or an exporting company or a retailer company, your key criteria for buying is that you want to buy at the cheapest price, which is the lowest cost of ownership. But you cannot be in a situation where you are buying from a farmer by paying him a higher price and then selling to a customer at a lower price. You can perhaps do that in the first season to get some traction in the market, to align farmers, to get farmers to sell to you, but you can't keep on doing it all the time. Now to explain this a little more deeply, let's look at this working example of grains and vegetables. And therefore, let us consider two examples under two ways of buying. The first is farmer buying and the second is buying from the traders. Now imagine a situation wherein you are assigned to buy or you want to buy during the next 3-4 months. You want to buy 20,000 tons of wheat from Bhopal in Madhya Pradesh, or you want to buy 5,000 tons of tomatoes from Alwar in Rajasthan. The first thing that comes is, look at the number of buying points, the number of warehouses that you need to create. When you buy from the farmer, the maximum that you can buy in year one or year three is about 2,000 tons per center. So when you're buying from the farmers, you necessarily have to open 10 buying points for wheat to buy those 20,000 tons and 10 buying points for tomatoes to buy those 5,000 tons of tomatoes. Now, when you go and book these warehouses or when you design these buying posts, there are expenses in terms of going to these locations, searching for these warehouses, negotiating the terms with each and every individual warehouse owner, doing a crop survey in these areas, going and studying the mandi arrivals. This versus if you're buying from the trade, you just need probably one or two buying posts. You need one or two large warehouses of 5 to 10,000 tons and you are done. So therefore, buying from the farmers would mean that you need 10 buying posts, whereas buying from the trade for the same quantity would mean that you need one or two buying posts. Now look at weighing scales. In each of the locations where you want to buy, you will have to put minimum 2 to 3 weighing scales. Because you will have, you know, at any given point of time, you will have 4 to 5 farmers or 6 to 7 farmers or even 15 to 20 farmers in your warehouse wanting to sell their material. You cannot keep a farmer waiting beyond a certain point of time. And therefore, you need to have 2 to 3 weighing scales. So if there are 10 buying points, you will end up having anywhere from 20 to 30 weighing scales versus if you have a singular buying point while buying from trade, you are comfortable having 5 to 7 buying points, weighing scales. And therefore, the cost of procurement of these weighing scales, taking these weighing scales from one location to all these 10 locations, and at the end of the season, getting these weighing scales back into your position, there are expenses related to that. While as the expenses related to weighing scales while buying from the trade are reasonably minimal. Look at gunny bags. How do gunny bags move? When you buy wheat, the farmer will come to you with wheat in a trolley or a little bit of wheat bagged and the rest of it in an open trolley. He will come to you and you will have to necessarily, you know, bag it in your procurement location. Then you will have to, you know, do that. You'll have to tie it with a machine. And therefore, you have to move the gunny bags from each location, from your main point to each of these 10 locations. Versus when you buy from a trade and when you buy from the trader, you get material pre-bagged material. You don't have to bag it at your end. And therefore, the expenses related to sending gunny bags to 10 different locations, to ensure the extra labor that is required to take the material from the farmer, to bag it in equal pack sizes, to stitch the material, versus the ease of getting these the commodity, be it wheat or tomatoes, totally pre-bagged in gunny bags It's far more simpler doing that under a trading model. Now look at the transportation as well. When you buy a wheat at 10 different warehouses when buying from farmers versus one or two buying posts, you have to consolidate the material at some point. And therefore, whenever you are moving wheat from north to south, it moves on railway wagons. You therefore have to take wheat from each of these buying posts, consolidate it either at the railway siding or at a mother warehouse, and then eventually sell it to put it on the railway wagon on the way to Bangalore or on the way to Cochin. Versus when you're buying from the trade, your wheat is totally accumulated at a single point. So there is no extra or any incremental transportation cost that you incur while moving the material from one location to another location. And therefore, all this is relatively cheaper as compared to buying from the farmers. Mandi tax. As you know, that APMC charges, every APMC charges a mandi tax. While as there is a difference from state to state on how it is implemented and executed, but this is by and large the underlying philosophy. Again, if you have 10 buying points while buying from the farmer versus 2 buying points while buying from the trade, you will have to deposit mandi tax at the end of every month for each of those 10 locations, possibly in 3 to 4 locations or possibly even in 10 locations, versus depositing the mandi tax at the end of every month in 1 or 2 locations. So the administrative complexity and the taxation complexity under the trading model is far more simpler than versus the trade model. Just wait, huh? All right. Now, so the next point is documentation. For whenever you are buying material, whenever you have wheat or tomatoes or corn or any commodity coming into your warehouse, you need a weighing slip, you need a goods receipt note, you need to make a material transfer note whenever you are moving material. And all these documents need to be entered into a software system. That is how companies, quantify the material. That is how companies decide and account for the material as to which trader, as to how much amount needs to be paid to which trader in which location. And therefore, if you have 10 buying posts, usually what happens is you need so many extra sets of documents. So either you have to put up a software system or an accounting system in each of these buying posts, or all these documents have to be physically collected at the end of the day and then taken to an accounting location or to the mother warehouse location. And then this data has to be inputted. There is also a relevance of units, like Shreya had mentioned in the beginning. So if you buy from the farmer, every farmer will sell you maybe 1 or 2 tons or maybe 2 to 3 tons. And therefore, your documentation, your GRN, weighing slip, MTN, has to be made for that 2 tons or 3 tons. And therefore, if you're buying 100 tons, you probably will have to, issue maybe about 30-40 GRNs or 20-30 GRNs. When you're buying from the trade, you will probably buy 100 tons in a single shot, and you will probably, issue maybe 1 or 2 GRNs for that. So therefore, the number of documents that need to be issued, that need to be printed, that need to be moved, as well as the number of documents that need to be, inputted into your software system, there's a huge difference. And therefore, while buying under the farmers, the number of accountants in your team increases significantly because you need to process the documents within a certain period of time. There is a fair degree of complexity because the documents come from multiple places that gets uploaded into a single place. Then the payments have to be processed online to either the farmer's account or to your franchisee's account, and that adds to significant delay as well as significant costs. The next is on manpower. Now at every buying post, you probably need one person for documentation, accounts, and for arranging the transportation. You need one person to look after weighment, who's going to be there at the weighing scale and issuing the weighment slips. And then you need one person to be managing the labor as well as the storage within the warehouse. And therefore, if you have 10 buying posts, you probably need anywhere, from 2 to 3 people per buying post. And therefore, for buying 20,000 tons of wheat, you probably end up needing, you need 30 to 35 people when you're buying from the farmers, versus you'll probably need maybe 5 or max, not even 6 people. You'll need 5 people, including your office boy, your admin staff, when buying from the trade. And therefore, the cost of employees is significant when you're buying from the farmers as compared to buying from the trade. Then there are other expenses as well. There are expenses related to fumigation. There are expenses related to insurance. There are expenses related to security. Expenses related to weight loss. And let's address these one by one. Fumigation means, to fumigate the material. You kind of spray a chemical on top of the material so as to keep it clean and, to maintain the nutritional content and to kill the pests and those kind of things. Now, if you have to send a fumigation agency to 10 locations versus sending it to one location, there's a difference. The cost of insurance, when you seek insurance for 10 warehouses in, these God-forsaken locations, the cost of insurance goes up. Security, you probably need 10 security guards for these 10 buying posts versus you need maybe 1 or 2 security people for 2 buying posts. Weight loss. The loss in the weight of the material while moving it from those 10 locations to a mother warehouse is significant as compared to what you have in your single warehouse when buying from the farmers. Quality discount. Now, when you get the material and if it's not of the desired quality that you want, if the wheat is not of the quality or if the tomatoes are a little rotten, it is extremely difficult to enforce a discount from the farmer on account of poor quality. While as it is an accepted trade practice of enforcing discounts on quality while buying from the trade. And therefore, the cost of ownership of material is relatively cheaper while buying from the trade. Payments. Now, when you buy from the farmers, you have to pay him in cash and you have to make on-the-spot payment. When you buy from the trader, you can pay him after 7 days. Again, when you have to buy from the farmers, you have to buy across, you have to make payments in those 10 different locations. Versus when you buy from the farmer, when you buy from the trade, you have to make, a payment in a singular location. And therefore, all these things reduce the cost as the case may be. Let's also look at political interference. When you're buying from the farmers, there's a higher degree of political interference. You cannot switch on and switch off procurement. Yeah, when you're buying from the farmer, you have to continuously keep on buying on all the days, irrespective of the price. While as when you're buying from the trade, you can easily switch on and switch off the procurement. If you don't want to buy on a single, on certain days because you feel that the price is high, you don't have to buy. You are under no compulsion to buy. While as under the farmer model of buying, you necessarily have to keep on buying on all days, irrespective of where the price is. Sometimes you also need to pay a higher price to the farmer as compared to the mandi price. While as with the traders, you can negotiate the price to the best of your ability. Let's also look at procurement licenses. Usually, for every APMC, you require a separate license. And therefore, if you have 10 buying points, you probably require about 3-4 licenses to cover those 10 locations. In the good old days, in 2004-2005, the government in a few states decided to change it from a single location, from a single license, from multiple licenses to a single license. However, it was an extremely challenging task to get these licenses. So I was with Cargill, like I mentioned earlier, for 7 years. I was heading their procurement and operations for India. And this was in the period 2003-2004 till about 2010. So getting a unified license, as it was called in UP, Uttar Pradesh, was quite a task. We would fly from New Delhi and we would keep on waiting at the entry gate of UP Secretariat for hours. And even when we would get to meet the secretary for agricultural production, it used to be an endless discussion. And it was very difficult and quite a time-consuming process to get the license. Let's also look at expectations of the farming community versus the trading community. The farmers expect you to buy multiple commodities. You cannot just open a center and say that I'll only buy wheat I will not buy your ginger, I will not buy your garlic, or I'll not buy your mustard, or I'll not buy your barley. They expect you to buy most of the commodities that they produce. They expect to be paid in cash across all locations. They want payment on the spot. They don't want any deduction on quality. They want a price which is higher than the mandi, and they want arrangements for rest and water. While as with the traders, they are businessmen who just want a fair price and they want to be paid within 7 days. So therefore, it's a far more simpler expectation management when comparing the two business models. Let's also look at contractual sanctity. While as there are no contracts when buying from the farmer, under a contractual model also, wherever contract buying, contract farming takes place, it's very difficult to enforce a contract on a farmer. Whereas the traders, they are bound by the contractual that they signed, contractual obligations. So contracts usually have 5 things: price, quality, quantity, delivery period, and delivery payment method. And they are bound by all the clauses on all these 5 things. And therefore, if we do a recap of 13 points actually, the first is number of buying points, higher in farmer, lower in trader. Number of weighing scales, higher in farmer, lower in trader. Delivery of gunny bags, very challenging in the farming model. Cost and availability of labor and transportation across 10 locations, far more expensive than with the trading model. Payment of money tax in 10 locations versus 10, very difficult. Very easy documentation of the trading buying model as compared to the farmer buying model. Number of manpower, you would need 10 people or you need 5 people in a trading buying model, while as under the farmer model, you probably need 25 to 30 people. Costs like fumigation, insurance, and weight loss are lesser in a trading model as compared to a farmer buying model. Ability to discount on poor quality is non-existent under a farmer buying model. You need to pay on the spot to a farmer versus the credit payment that you get versus in a trading model. The degree of political interference is higher in a farmer model buying model. The farmer's demand to buy multiple commodities exists in a farmer model. And finally, your ability to switch on and switch off procurement is non-existent in a farmer buying model. While in a trading buying model, you can switch off procurement and you can refuse to buy if the price is high. While as under a farmer buying model, you have to keep on buying irrespective of the price point in the mandi. And therefore, even today, when you speak to the larger and established agribusiness companies, which have an experience in supply chain management, like ADM, Bunge, Cargill, Dreyfus, ITC, Mahindra, Tata, Godrej, Shriram, and if you ask them to get into a farmer buying model, they will never get into a farmer buying model. You therefore have a lot of agri startups, which perhaps have not had the learning and the experience which these larger companies have had, who are getting into the farmer buying model. Investors, of course, don't know any of this, what I have shared here, and therefore their knowledge and their ability to take judgment calls is fairly limited. However, that does not mean that you cannot buy from the farmer. You must surely buy from the farmer, provided it makes commercial sense. And the direct farmer buying model makes commercial sense only in certain scenarios. And there are four or five scenarios in which it makes commercial sense. One is if you're buying at a processing location. So if you have a dal mill, or if you have a brewery, or if you have a wheat mill, or if you have a tomato juicing unit, and if you buy commodities directly from the farmer at that location, it is fine, it is acceptable. You don't incur any extra expense there. Commodities with high margin and high value. So for example, if you plan to buy saffron, which is the world's most valuable commodity, most valuable agri commodity, there you can have a farmer buying model. Yeah, because the margins are pretty high. Now, certain commodities need a special protocol to be followed. For example, organic products produce. That requires certification. That requires, there are certain protocols that you need to follow in terms of non-usage of child labor. For example, when you are, buying or producing coffee under this Rainforest Alliance or producing cotton under Better Cotton Initiative, you have to certify that no child labor was used. So commodities that need a certain protocol like organic and all these things that I mentioned, there you can buy directly from the farmers. Farmers which typically have a large of land holding. So for example, in the US, a typical farmer would have land anywhere in the area of about 2,000 to even 10,000 hectares. So there it makes sense to buy directly from the farmers. Herbs and medicinal plants, which are of a special nature, that also you can buy from a farmer directly because they are very high value items. And again, herbs and medicinal plants also undergo processing to a fair degree, and then the margin in that processing is quite high. And therefore, direct farmer buying makes sense in these five scenarios. Also, when it is not your own money. So if you are looking to raise money from investors, and if you are able to fool an investor to invest $10 million or $100 million, saying that, you know, this is what I will do and this is the promised land. As long as it is not your own money, you can buy directly from the farmers. Also remember, there will always be money in the Excel sheets. But those 13 points and 12 points that I mentioned, those points are never captured in an Excel sheet. Those points are things that you experience as you go along. And that, and therein lies the difference, that your trading buying model and your trade buying model will always at any day be cheaper than the farmer buying model. And therefore, in this debate of direct farmer buying and trade buying, your own conscience needs to be your guide. Thank you so much. Questions and answers, I'm open.
Yes, Nitinji, please.
Now, participants may ask their questions.
Girish ji, thank you for this good perspective. In the times when we are thinking of direct marketing options to be open for the farmers. However, I would just like to know, is it just that the whole process seems to be cumbersome, therefore the companies are a little kind of not encouraged to buy from the farmers? And what if the farmers, they organize themselves as FPO? Because FPOs are coming in a big way. So do you think these FPOs are going to be in a better position to kind of trade with the companies like ITC and Bunge and Cargill?
All right. Thank you for your question, ma'am. As far as the FPOs are concerned, as long as they deliver to a single warehouse in larger lots, it makes sense for companies to organize that kind of a model. However, having said that, if they are FPOs, they would be delivering huge quantities and larger quantities than an individual farmer. And that delivery can happen at a larger warehouse as compared to opening these multiple smaller locations to buy directly from the farmers.
Participants, if you have.
Well, anyone having any questions, please feel free to ask. Otherwise, we are done. All right. I take it that there is nothing to ask, and it was fairly clear and simple. So, thank you so much.
Thank you, Girish ji. Thanks a lot. I, on the behalf of Director General Niham and entire Niham team, and on the behalf of Center, would like to thanks for the insightful presentation. Thank you, everyone, for joining us.
One question on my side.
Okay.
Yeah.
Please.
Yeah, please.
Due to network failure, I am not getting properly. Are you getting my voice?
Yes, I am.
I am Ashwini Jojra, Journal Officer from Agriculture Department, Jammu.
Sir.
Thank you for sensitizing everything and you are enlightening us. Our government and central government is also providing the great support to the farmers for in organic farming.
Sir.
We have a project of the organic basmati rice cluster at Suchetgarh Extreme IB border, international border.
Yeah, I know that.
And from the last, it is a 5-year plan, and that 3 or 4 years have gone, and they are producing very good rice. And how this program and how you can help our border based farmers at the international border for the basmati and other products?
How can we help?
Yeah, how it can be of any use to it?
No, sir, we are not in the business of procurement.
Definitely, but how the small and the marginal farmers can be benefited?
Well, then what you need to do is you need to collect that entire material, make it into a sizable quantity, and then try and sell it to a rice mill.
Okay, they have their produce. As government has provided the great machinery and very good machinery to them, they are producing, and the farmer interest groups and the FOGs, farm producer groups, FPOs.
Right, sir.
Yeah.
Well, sir, you have a higher chance of getting a better price from a processing company than from a local artia. So if you have a dedicated number of farmers with you, you can collect their entire produce and then go and meet a processor directly in Jammu. So the good thing with rice and wheat is that you have millers in every city, so you can go and sell it to a processor directly. He will be able to give you a better price than what your local artia or a local village level consolidator will be able to give you.
Thank you very much. Actually, we are heading towards Maniya Pradhan Mantri has also said that for doubling of the income, and the people are very much doing well in accordance of it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Pleasure to speak to people from Jammu any day.
Shukriya, Grish. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Any more questions from the participants' side?
Right. Thank you so much.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the insightful presentation.
Right.
On behalf of NIAM team, I would like to thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am.
All the best. Right. Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.